can a deterministic computer produce genuinely random numbers? And does it even need to? Computers need to have access to random numbers. They're used to encrypt information, deal cards in your game of virtual solitaire, simulate unknown variables like in weather prediction and airplane scheduling, and so much more. But how are those random numbers generated? Computers are deterministic, meaning their actions are determined by a prescribed set of instructions. How can it possibly produce a random number? Well, as Donald Knuth put it in The Art of Computer Programming, in a sense, there is no such thing as a random number. For example, is 2 a random number? Rather, we speak of a sequence of independent random numbers with a specified distribution. To simulate the role of a die, you'll want to create a sequence of random numbers x0, x1, x2, x3, and so on, each of which has a 1/6 chance of being each number between 1 and 6. That's the specified distribution. But how can a deterministic computer do that? Now, computers can generate sequences of truly random numbers, but they rely on some type of external input from a process which we assume to be random. They inherit the randomness of the world. Random number generators typically measure some random physical phenomenon using an extra piece of hardware, like a Geiger counter, which tabulates background radiation over a short period of time. The sequence will be random because radiation is. But these types of number generators have major disadvantages. For one, they require extra hardware. Also, they're not very fast. It takes a while to gather all that external data. And the random number generation is not reproducible. If you're testing a program, you'll likely want to repeatedly use the same set of random inputs to distinguish the features of the randomness from the features of your program, which isn't easy when the randomness derives from physical phenomenon. Fortunately, most of the time, we don't need to produce actually random numbers. They just need to seem random. This is where pseudorandom numbers enter the picture. Sequences of pseudorandom numbers look like sequences of genuinely random numbers and have many of the statistical properties associated with random numbers, but they are actually produced using a deterministic process. That is, they follow a set rule, a pattern. For example, here's John von Neumann's middle square algorithm. You start with a number called the seed. Let's say it's a 4-digit number, like 4,321. As the algorithm's name suggests, you square it and extract the middle 4 digits. That's the next term in the sequence. Then you just repeat that process. For all n, define x sub n plus 1 as the middle 4 digits of x sub n squared. If the square has less than 8 digits, pad it with leading zeros until it's 8 digits long and extract the middle 4. Starting with a 4-digit seed, the middle square algorithm generates a sequence of random-looking numbers between 0 and 9,999. This is definitely not the only way to create a random-looking sequence of numbers. The current gold standard for pseudo-random number generators, the Mersenne Twister, is based on the much simpler linear congruential generator. So we'll start there. The linear congruential generator has 4 inputs: the modulus m, the multiplier a, the increment c, and the seed, the sequence's starting value. We'll run with the example m equals 7,829, a equals 378, c equals 2,310, and the seed is 4,321, again. Multiply the seed by a, add c to that, and then take the whole thing mod m. In other words, you look at the remainder when it's divided by m. In our example, that gives 7,216. Repeat this over and over to get the rest of the sequence. X sub n plus 1 is equal to a times x sub n plus c mod m. The numbers in the resulting sequence will be between 0 and 7,828, which is m minus 1. With all these options for creating random-ish sequences, how do you decide whether to use a genuine random number generator or one of the 2 pseudo-random number generators, the middle square method or the linear congruential algorithm? Remember that one of the downfalls of generating truly random numbers by measuring some physical phenomenon, for example using a Geiger counter, is that you cannot reproduce the sequence, which can make it difficult to test a program. But both of the pseudo-random number generators start with a seed, a single number which determines the entire sequence. If you want to test a program using the identical sequence of random numbers, you don't need to store the entire sequence. You just need to know the seed. That's a huge benefit that pseudo-random number generators have over random number generators. The sequence is easily replicable. They also don't require any special devices, and they are computationally efficient. The obvious disadvantage is that pseudo-random numbers are not actually random, but they can appear more or less random. Here's our sequence from the middle square algorithm, where the numbers range between 0 and 9,999. And here's our sequence from the linear congruential generator, where the numbers range between 0 and 7,828. Which one looks more random to you? But first, what does it mean for a sequence to be random? Well, there's no one way to determine if a sequence is random. Instead, there are many different statistical tests for randomness. For example, you could compute the running average, or mean, of the numbers. Or you could plot a histogram of them. For example, something that would make a sequence seem less random is if the same pattern of numbers kept showing up. Well, all sequences of pseudo-random numbers eventually repeat. In other words, the sequence cycles. The number of terms in the sequence before it repeats is called the period. If, for example, you're generating numbers between 0 and 9,999, it's impossible to go through more than 10,000 terms in your sequence without repeating a number. And as soon as it repeats a number, it has to start cycling. That's because pseudo-random number generators follow a rule, essentially a formula, by which each number in the sequence is determined from the previous number. The sequence can repeat very quickly. For example, if a sequence produced using von Neumann's middle square algorithm has the term 2916, then the next number is 5030, then 3009, then 540, and back to 2916, where it just keeps repeating. This cycle has period 4. Or if the term 0 ever shows up in the sequence, then it becomes 0000 and so on. It cycles with period 1. The pseudo-random sequence of numbers between 0 and 9,999 generated by the middle square algorithm will always cycle with a period smaller than 4,096. And as we've seen, the period can be much smaller. A sequence generated by the linear congruential generator will also repeat. But if we select good values for m, the modulus, a, the multiplier, and c, the increment, then the period will be m. So we want to pick a big value for m, like 2 to the 32nd kind of big. In general, the linear congruential generator will run for much longer before repeating than the middle square algorithm, which is one feature that makes it a more preferred pseudo-random number generator. And finally, I want to mention the distribution of these sequences. So far, we've looked at methods which produce random integers, or simulate it with pseudo-random integers, between 0 and some fixed value, like 9,999. In other words, the distribution is uniform on the integers between 0 and 9,999. But it's much more useful to have a sequence of numbers with the uniform distribution on the interval 0 to 1, which means that for any given term in the sequence, all the numbers between 0 and 1 are equally likely. Actually, since computers only have a certain amount of decimal precision, let's say, for a simplified example, that only the first 4 decimal digits matter, the uniform distribution on 0, 1 just means the uniform distribution on fractions of the form x over 10,000, where x is between 0 and 10,000. But that's easy to obtain. Just divide the sequence of integers by 10,000. This is useful because with a sequence of numbers with the uniform distribution on 0, 1, we can generate sequences of random numbers according to other distributions using something known as inverse transform sampling. Let's say we want to generate a sequence of random numbers with the normal distribution with mean 162 centimeters and standard deviation 5 centimeters to represent the height of an American woman. You may have seen this picture. It's the probability density function. Roughly, it tells you how likely a randomly selected American woman is to be that height. The function is highest around 162, since that's the most likely height, and really tiny at 181, since it's unlikely for someone to be that tall. Just for comparison, this is the probability density function of the uniform distribution on 0, 1. It's flat, since all points are equally likely. But now, let's talk about the cumulative distribution function. It tells you how likely you are to randomly select something below that value. For the uniform distribution, it's pretty easy. For a randomly selected point, there's a 0% chance it's smaller than 0, 50% chance it's smaller than 1/2, and an 100% chance it's smaller than 1. This is the cumulative distribution function for the heights of American women. The value of the function at a point x tells you the probability that a randomly selected woman will be shorter than x. Now, let's say I want a sequence of numbers which represents the height of a bunch of American women. In other words, we want to generate numbers according to this distribution. Fortunately, thanks to inverse transform sampling, we can do this using our uniform 0-1 sequence. Here's how. The first number in our sequence is 0.0671. So we locate that point on the cumulative distribution for heights whose y value is 0.0671. In other words, we find the height such that 6.71% of American women are shorter than that. The next number in our sequence is 0.9. So we use the cumulative distribution to locate the height such that 90% of American women are shorter than that, and so on, creating a new sequence. Let's check that this makes sense intuitively. Most American women are around this height. That's why the cumulative distribution function grows so quickly there. The steep slope corresponds to a high probability, and shallow slope to a low probability. We uniformly randomly select a point on the y-axis and then determine the point on the x-axis that gives that function value. And more of those points correspond to places of steep slope, of high probability. Less of them correspond to places of shallow slope, of low probability. Somewhat amazingly, this method allows us to transform the sequence of uniform 0-1 random or pseudo-random numbers into a sequence with a different distribution. Even with a deterministic computer, the truly random and pseudo-random techniques we explored give us numbers with the uniform 0-1 distribution, which in turn gives us sequences with other distributions, like the heights of American women, or wind speeds, or dice rolls. See you next time on Infinite Series. Hello. You all had lots of great responses to our second video on cops and robbers. Humberto Venegas asked, in the case of the infinitely branching tree, would there be one branch with infinitely many nodes? And in this case, would the robber be chased infinitely long on this branch? That's a great question. So in the case of the tree that we were talking about in that episode, none of the branches are infinitely long. They have length 1, length 2, length 3, and so on. So none of them are infinitely long, but they become arbitrarily long. It's kind of a weird distinction. There are infinitely many branches though. So the tree we were talking about is a copwin tree, because on any finite branch, the robber will eventually get caught. But if there were an infinitely long branch, then the tree would become robberwin, because the robber could just keep going along that infinitely long branch. So that's a great question. And we ask you guys two questions at the end, the challenge questions. So we ask for the cop number and lazy cop number of two graphs. And there were a lot of great responses, a lot of great proofs. A lot of them were really different too, which was cool. But our winner is Leonard Romano. And the answer is that the graph that looks like a star, it's called the Peterson graph. It has cop number and lazy cop number 3. They're the same in that case. But the graph that looks like a 3x3 grid, that has cop number 2, but lazy cop number 3. And so in your proofs, many of you pointed out that the cop number has to be less than or equal to the lazy cop number. That was a great insight. All right, see you next time.